The key word in Proverbs is wisdom, but for every positive, there's a negative. True wisdom comes from our Heavenly Father through the true Christ, the tree of life, but false wisdom, which isn't wisdom at all but deception, comes from Satan, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. There is no truth in him, as Christ said in John chapter 8, verse 44. There are two family trees, and you're either part of one family tree or the other. Satan's family tree, death being one of Satan's names, or God's family tree, the many-membered body of the true Christ, the tree of life. So with that having been said, Proverbs chapter 18, verse 1, with a word of wisdom from our Father in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Through desire, a man having separated himself, seeketh and intermeddleth with all wisdom. Desire in the negative sense, greed or lust, that is to say, and to intermeddleth means to argue against all wisdom, which is to reject God's truth. That's what will separate you from the tree of life, and the first time we see this word translated desire is in Genesis chapter 3, where Eve was beguiled into believing Satan's deception, which led to the conception of Cain. In the future sense, those who are deceived into worshiping Satan when he appears as Antichrist in Jerusalem will be impregnated also, spiritually speaking, in their forehead with the mark of the beast, the deception, that is to say, which is why Christ says in Matthew 24, "Woe unto them that are with child, those who were deceived into worshiping Satan instead of Christ and were grafted onto Satan's family tree." The tree of the knowledge of good and evil, separating themselves from the tree of life, which is God's family tree, rejecting and arguing against all wisdom, receiving not the love of the truth, that is to say, the seal of God in your forehead, the truth of God's word in your mind, remaining a virgin, spiritually speaking, waiting for the true husband to return at the seventh trumpet. Verse 2, a fool hath no delight in understanding, again, receiving not the love of the truth, but that his heart, which means his mind, may discover itself. He wants everyone to hear his words as opposed to God's words, and that comes from having pride within himself or herself. There's no gender there. And always remember, it was pride within himself that caused Satan to rebel in the first world age. Satan being called a king over all the children of pride in Job chapter 41 in the final verse. So one with pride within themselves, having no delight in understanding, ends up in Satan's family tree and will ultimately perish in the lake of fire after the millennium, unless they repent. Verse 3, when the wicked cometh, then cometh also contempt, and with ignominy, which means shame, reproach, ultimately the shame of realizing they worship Satan, that wicked one, because when the true Christ returns, all are changed into spiritual bodies, and they'll realize they've been deceived. That's why Christ says in Revelation 16, "Behold, I come as a thief." That means unexpectedly. Most people won't be expecting Christ to return because they'll think he's already here. "Blessed is he that watcheth and keepeth his garments, lest he walk naked and they see his shame." When a Christian worships the devil, they lose all credit for their righteous acts that make up their clothing that they wear in the spiritual body, making them naked. The words of a man's mouth are as deep waters and the wellspring of wisdom as a flowing brook. All wisdom comes from our Heavenly Father, that living water, which is the true Christ. But again, for every positive, there's a negative, and the bitter water that comes from Satan's mouth is his deception that brings about spiritual death as opposed to eternal life. The words of a man's mouth depend on what's in a man's forehead. Is it the truth of God's word or is it not? Verse 5, it is not good to accept the person of the wicked, to overthrow the righteous in judgment. Again, Cain was of that wicked one, and the sons of Cain, the Kenites, you're expected to stay away from. Know and understand who they are. Count those stones worn smooth over a long period of time, but keep your distance. And if there come any unto you who confess not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh, receive him not into your house, neither bid him Godspeed. For he that biddeth him Godspeed is a partaker of his evil deeds. Keep your distance, don't support them, but know and understand who they are. It is not good to accept the person of the wicked, to overthrow the righteous in judgment. Many biblically illiterate Christians will even take sides against those who don't support the Kenites. Within that, we can already see the foreshadowing of the great apostasy, when most Christians are deceived into worshiping Satan when he appears as Antichrist. That's when they're grafted onto Satan's family tree, and the natural branches of Satan's family tree are the Kenites, the sons of Cain. A fool's lips enter into contention, and his mouth calleth for strokes or stripes that are given for correction. They're asking for it, in other words, because had they absorbed God's word and obtained wisdom and understanding, which can only be obtained through Christ, they wouldn't be a fool, and wisdom would flow from their lips, not stupidity. A fool fool's mouth is his destruction, and his lips are the snare of his soul. Again, cease to be a fool and become wise so you don't end up blotted out in the lake of fire after the 1,000 years are finished. The words of a talebearer, a gossip, are as wounds, and they go down to the innermost parts of the belly. A lot of damage can be done by someone with nothing better to do than spread gossip and rumors. Meanwhile, those who are using their time wisely and studying our Father's word receive the blessings of Deuteronomy 28, not the curses. Verse 9, he also that is slothful in his work is brother to him that is a great waster, a great destroyer. Again, use your time wisely. Study God's word so that you can plant seeds and bring forth fruit for the kingdom of God. Otherwise, what good are you? If you're a Christian and a branch of God's family tree, what happens to you if you don't bear fruit? We find the answer to that in John chapter 15, where Christ says, I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me, the tree of life, the true Christ, that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. So if you call yourself a Christian, but you're not planting seeds with people every chance you get so that God willing they can come to repentance, you're missing the point completely. Don't be slothful in your work as a Christian, which is to plant seeds of truth from our Father's word. It doesn't even have to be done verbally. There's a multitude of ways to plant seeds nowadays. Just do it. But you must first absorb the word of God with understanding as best you can and make sure you're not mixing your seeds with falsehood. That's why we are to study our Father's word chapter by chapter, verse by verse, rightly dividing the word of truth. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous runneth into it and is safe. The name of Yahweh, Jesus being translated, means Yahweh's Savior. And in his name, Christ gives us power over all our enemies, as we know from Luke chapter 10. As Christians, all we need do if we come into contact with an evil spirit is to say, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I command you to go to the abyss. And they have to listen. But as Christ also says in Luke chapter 10, notwithstanding in this, rejoice not that the spirits are subject unto you through his name, as we know from verse 17, but rather rejoice because your names are written in heaven. The rich man's wealth is his strong city, and as an high wall in his own conceit. His own conceit being his own imagination, trusting in money rather than trusting in God. Money won't help you when the true Christ returns, and as it's written in Zephaniah chapter 1 verse 18, neither their silver nor their gold shall be able to deliver them in the day of the Lord's wrath. 1,000 years that begin when the true Christ returns. So to imagine your money to be a wall of protection is literally insanity. Only God can protect you, because only God has the power to cast you into the lake of fire. It isn't money itself that's evil. A lot of good can be done with it to further God's word, but the love of money is the root of all evil. Better translated, all manner of evil. Loving anything or anyone more than you love our Heavenly Father is to break the first and great commandment. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind, as it's written in Matthew chapter 22, verse 37. This goes back to the desire we saw in the first verse of this chapter, greed or lust. That's how one separates themselves from God's family tree, unless they repent. Verse 12, before destruction, the heart of man is haughty, which means prideful, and before honor is humility. Whosoever exalts himself will be abased, and he that humbleth himself shall be exalted, as Christ says in Luke chapter 14, verse 11. And here we see pride ultimately leads to destruction, and Satan will be destroyed after the 1,000 years are finished, along with whoever follows him at that time. All who insist on being the children of pride and part of Satan's family tree, and that's the tree that's burned into nothing in the lake of fire after the 1,000 years are finished. But those who are part of God's family tree at that time, the tree of life, go into the eternity, which is the third world age. Verse 13, he that answereth a matter before he heareth it, it is folly and shame unto him. Don't jump to conclusions, in other words, and in the case of a new truth from God's word being brought to your attention, check it out before you shoot it down. Find out from the word of God whether it's true or false. And by new truth, I mean new to you, something you may have not realized before. And at the same time, don't take any man's word for it, but rather study to show thyself approved, rightly dividing the word of truth. The spirit of man will sustain his infirmity, will keep him in sickness, but a wounded spirit who can bear? The spirit, which is the intellect of the soul of a man without being connected to God's Holy Spirit through Christ, will keep one in sickness, spiritually speaking, even leading to the spiritual death and the plagues of Revelation 16. The first plague causing a noisome and grievous leave his sword to fall on the men which have the mark of the beast and upon them which worship his image. Those who cease to be Christians when they worship Antichrist at the sixth trumpet, wounding their spirit by uniting their spirits with Satan's evil spirit, which is one reason Satan is called the Desolator. He makes one desolate of God's spirit whenever they begin to worship Satan instead of Christ, which is what Antichrist means, the image of the beast being an image of Satan himself transmitted throughout the world via satellite. Verse 15, the heart, which means the mind of the prudent, getteth knowledge from God's word, so they're not deceived into receiving the mark of the beast, and the ear of the wise seeketh knowledge. He that hath ears to hear, let him hear, as Christ says many times throughout the Gospels, as well as the book of Revelation. The parable of the sower in Matthew chapter 13 ends with Christ saying, who hath ears to hear, let him hear. A man's gift maketh room for him, and bringeth him before great men. The gifts written of in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, the first on the list being the word of wisdom, but regardless of whatever your gift may be, a man's gift maketh room for him because it was given by God to be utilized in bringing the lost into the many-membered body. It bringeth him before great men, ultimately in the eternity when we're nothing but the many-membered body of Christ, the tree of life. Verse 17, he that is first in his own cause seemeth just, but his neighbor cometh and searcheth him. This goes back to verse 13, don't jump to conclusions and always listen to both sides of the story before deciding what the truth of the matter is. In a court of law, the first one to plead their case might seem to be the one in the right, but then comes the cross-examination where everything they might have left out is brought into it. Wait until you have all the information before you decide what the truth of the matter is. And as far as rightly dividing the word goes, again, after hearing out a sermon or lecture, we have to then be able to document everything that was said in God's word to verify whether it's truth or not. That's studying to show ourselves approved so that we aren't deceived. Verse 18, the lot causeth contentions to cease and parteth between the mighty. Casting lots means using pebbles or small stones to determine a verdict, but this is in the positive sense, as in the lively stones that come from the true rock written of in 1 Peter chapter 2 verse 5. Those who are in Christ Jesus and having obtained wisdom from the word of God can make a right judgment, causing contentions to cease. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God, as Christ says in Matthew chapter 5 verse 9. The children of God as opposed to the children of the wicked one, which is what those smooth stones are in the negative sense. For every positive, there's a negative. Christ is the true rock. The false rock is Satan, the king of Tyrus, as he's called in Ezekiel chapter 28. Tyrus means rock, and parteth between the mighty just means to settle a dispute. This word translated mighty is used many times in reference to Israel, that is to say Christianity, because if you're in Christ, you're Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise, as it's written in Galatians chapter 3. If you're not in Christ, then you're not Abraham's seed. And as it's written in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, dare any of you, having a matter against another, go to law before the unjust and not before the saints? So settle things amongst yourselves as Christians, and again, blessed are the peacemakers. Verse 19, a brother offended is harder to be won than a strong city, and their contentions are like the bars of a castle. But again, the lot, in the positive sense of the word, that is to say the lively stones that come from the true rock, causeth contentions to cease, using wisdom to make a right judgment, which can only be obtained through our Father's word. Experience is necessary in learning also, but without God's word guiding us and leading us on a day-to-day basis, we'd be void of understanding, and that's how you get deceived. Verse 20, a man's belly shall be satisfied with the fruit of his mouth, and with the increase of his lips he shall be filled. The fruit of your mouth depends on which tree you're a part of. Those who hear the word of God and do it plant seeds of truth, whereby God willing, others can come out of the darkness and into the light also. Filling your belly in the spiritual sense means those who hunger and thirst for righteousness shall be filled, as Christ says in Matthew chapter 5, verse 6. Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. They that love it, meaning those who use words, that is to say the power of the tongue in their occupation, whether it be to lead people to the tree of life by preaching the word of God, or to lead people to the tree of death, which is the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, the fruit being the product of the words one uses, and everyone will be judged according to their works. For by thy words thou shalt be justified, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned, as Christ says in in Matthew chapter 12, "Whosoever shall confess that Jesus is the Son of God, God dwelleth in him and he in God." So death and life are in the power of the tongue. Those who do not confess that Jesus is the Son of God are spiritually dead until they repent. "Whoso findeth a wife findeth a good thing and obtaineth favor of the Lord." A good wife, that is to say, and on the deeper level, through planting seeds and preaching the word, you produce fruit when God causes the seeds to grow, and when they confess that Jesus is the Son of God, they're added onto the many-membered body, which is the virgin bride of Christ, spiritually speaking. "The poor useth entreaties," which means earnest prayer, "but the rich answereth roughly," or greedily. In other words, rather than basing their decisions on God's word, those rich with ill-gotten gains base all their decisions on increasing their material wealth. You can't serve God and mammon, as Christ says in Matthew chapter 6, verse 24. This especially applies in the futurist sense, because those who refuse to worship Antichrist during the sixth trumpet can't buy or sell within his one-world religious system. But as Christ also says in Matthew 6, in the very next verse, "Take no thought for your life what ye shall eat or what ye shall drink," and then in verse 26, "Behold, the fowls of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are ye not much better than they?" Don't you think God is going to appreciate one of his children that loves him enough to study his word chapter by chapter and verse by verse and to stand against Satan's one world system? Of course, God takes care of his own, and if you love our heavenly Father more than your own comfort zone, you'll get through the hour of temptation just fine. I repeat, God takes care of his own. A man that hath friends must show himself friendly, and there is a friend that sticketh closer than a brother, and you know who this friend is that sticketh closer than a brother. You'll find it in John chapter 15, the same chapter where Christ, the tree of life, tells us he is the true vine, and we, as Christians, are the branches. If we abide in Christ, we will bear fruit. And in verse 14, Christ says, "Ye are my friends if ye do whatsoever I command you."